Hello and greetings from Iceland. We have plenty to talk about today since the Reykjanes Peninsula is shaking again. And then we have some strange things going on by the Askja Volcano. And I will be ending this with a little sightseeing tour while I talk about how I'm structuring my channel into the future. But let's start with the good old Reykjanes Peninsula, where we got this rather strong earthquake swarm just 2 days ago that actually seems to be fading out now. But what's interesting this time is of course the location, or offshore. And I have mentioned this location often before as perhaps the most likely place to be the next to erupt. And as usual, the earthquakes are by the plate boundaries and line up in the usual southwest to northeast direction. And I fully admit that I did measure the distance from the shore to this spot where the earthquakes are to see if my drone had range to go there. And yes, it had. Or when it comes to the first earthquakes, but later the swarm took off a bit further away. So the action has been amidst between the coast and this little island out there called Elday or Fire Island. So in case of an eruption, it's not going to be all that simple. And there are volcanoes of all sizes and shapes under there. And of course, this might just be one of those cycles that we have been seeing every 3-4 months usually. But things have been relatively quiet since the last eruption came to an end last August. And to make this simple, this area looks to me as the weakest link, or where the mid-Atlantic ridge and the plate boundaries rise up from the seabed, and thereafter it is called Iceland, or until the plate boundaries disappear into the ocean by the north coast. And that will be the part of the plate boundaries that we cover next, starting by Askja Volcano, where we have already detected 50 centimeter land uplift, and this very strange earthquake pattern constantly changing, like I have been talking about recently. But we do have a new discovery there. The latest move from Mother Earth was to melt a big part of the ice that covers this lake. This is a highland lake, so it's all frozen now, usually. And this melting is more than we usually see. This is not a completely unknown phenomenon, or to have some melting going on there. And the lake happens to sit on top of a magma chamber that's expanding fast during this huge magma intrusion that's taking place there. So it is in fact a recipe for something that might turn very nasty. And I'm also noticing how widespread the earthquakes are along this part of the plate boundaries. So I have to make a time lapse soon to compare the seismic activity with the last few years. And as I was checking out some of those unusual earthquakes, I found this magnitude 2.5 not far away from Lake Mývatn, or on this fault that runs through this mountain. So I have a new Icelandic place name for you today, or Heilagsdalsfjall, or Holy Valley Mountain. So we have a Holy Valley just nearby. And this is the kind of footage that always gets me going, or faults. And aerial photos from planes do only so much for me. So I added this place to my long list of shooting locations next summer. So let's move further north to the northernmost part of the plate boundaries. And that's where things get interesting again. But first I want to mention an earthquake swarm near the town Kópasker, where the last large earthquake in North Iceland occurred in 1976, magnitude 6.3. And of course, this doesn't have to mean anything. There are always earthquakes on those long and strange fault lines, or the so-called Tjörnes fracture zone. All I'm doing is looking after the weakest spots now. But the most interesting thing though is what I learned last week from an interview with one of our professors, where he was speaking about those earthquakes in Syria and Turkey. And one of his comments was much more significant than the reporter obviously realized. But it goes like this. The largest earthquakes in Turkey have been of similar magnitude to what can be expected in this country. So he is talking about a 7.8, and now I have to say that this is something completely new to me. In general, in textbooks and just wherever we look for information, it's stated that the largest earthquakes in Iceland are of a magnitude 7, perhaps 7.1. But all of a sudden, we are talking about a magnitude 7.8. And as for the energy, there is a long way between a 7 and a 7.8. So, before I dive into that, I have to remind you of a video I made last year about Iceland's most dangerous fault up north. And while I was gathering information for that video, I found some geological reports online that showed this huge shift on this fault just by the town less than 2,500 years ago. And less than 200 years ago, this town was flattened twice. And the second earthquake was so powerful that the sea retreated out of the bay and turned back in the form of a tsunami. And those are most likely the best documented earthquakes from this period, or the 1800s. And the seismic unrest then was way more than our generation has ever seen. So those were very tough times. And some of the seismic episodes during the 1800s were related to the volcanic eruption in Askja in 1875, where the ice is melting now, on the lake that sits on the collapsed magma chamber since then. And the video I made about this fault was one of those videos where I got a bit of a shock while making it. I did a lot of research and browsed through all sorts of reports and old tales. And I even drove there for the second time when I found out about a huge displacement where the fault comes up from the seafloor around here. And those earthquakes in the 1800s were around magnitude 7. But a geology report from 2005 is showing way more displacement from older earthquakes that occurred around 2,500 years ago. So, of course it occurred to me that the earthquake risk in Iceland is even greater than we have heard so far. And when this professor, who I believe is one of our finest scientists, mentioned this 7.8 as a possibility here, it is in fact big news. And my first thought was that he has to be referring to this area here, the Reykjanes fracture zone. And I'm of course not mentioning this now to scare people or indicate that such an earthquake is foreseeable. I'm much more asking what changed, what made the professor say this now, because we are talking about a statement that makes it necessary to change all textbooks about geology. So this is a big deal. So I have many questions now and I will be mentioning how I plan to get them answered. So I'm ending this today with some of the plans I've been making recently. I took a break from editing to sort out some of my hard drives. Last year was busy for me, I filmed a lot more than I could process, and then I have all those project folders with ideas, photos, videos and scripts, and it's easy to lose track of things when they are all over my computer and hard drives. So it has been taking me a few days to sort through all the footage, or something that I had actually planned to do while I was processing videoclips and photographs for photostock agencies. But it turned out to be a huge work and taking me way longer than I expected. And I really don't like to have a mess around me. So I have now a sort of inventory list with all projects and project ideas. And right now I'm prioritizing all the projects or exactly what I needed to structure my workflow better. And I can tell you that I am moving closer to documentary filmmaking, which has been my long-term goal for some time. And this interview with this professor was reminding me so well of the necessity of interviewing experts, especially the questions that the reporters don't ask. And it reminded me also that I need a second camera for such work, and then I need some sound recording equipment, good enough to be used to do interviews in a documentary. And there is no place better than YouTube to practice with that. And I want to thank you again for your thermal drone donations. I'm actually halfway there. I have selected the drone, moving from DJI to Autel, where I get more for the money. Since as things are now, this is costing me about 10 months worth of YouTube income. So I'm sure you understand why I asked for this help. But to be halfway already is telling me that everything will be fine. It takes some time more, but when I got the news about the melting ice on Lake Askja, I have to admit that I was feeling a bit impatient. And this possible submarine eruption wasn't helping me either, because a thermal drone can detect the heat on the ocean surface or before an eruption comes up. So for me, this is a kind of a magma intrusion scanner, but for now, I'm just scanning the market for good microphones and doing a list with the experts I would like to talk to or to get some practice doing interviews. So that will be coming soon, since this is from my own budget. And what has stopped me so far when it comes to interviews is, of course, my own limited background, making it harder for me when I started to find and ask all the important questions. But all I have to do now is just to browse through some of my older videos about geology, and I will find more questions there than a geologist could answer in one day. And those are all questions that I know that most of you would like to hear answered. And then I have all this drone footage, where I have another set of talking points, like the footage from the huge fault up north, and I think it's the sort of bait I need to get some of our experts to speak up, let it all out, with whiskey and coffee if needed, or a good chunk of rotten shark meat, just whatever it takes to make them talk. And from time to time, I'm getting requests from scientists and students to publish photos with articles and reports, telling me that I'm doing something right when it comes to going after geological formations with a drone. So I have every reason now to take this to the next level. And there I am, halfway into documentary filmmaking. The rest is just more structure, music, transitions and graphics, or all the fancy stuff that I don't do in my usual vlogs. And it was my plan to do my first documentary about the Ásbyrgi formation, the river and the canyons, or the huge flood that carved this out. And my plan was to do the complete canyons, all the way from the north coast up to the glacier, where no one seems to know what happened and caused this flood, million cubic meters per second. But I would need a helicopter for at least one day. And for that kind of money, I would not bring just any camera. The canyons deserve at least 8K, so I can crop out the best parts if needed and do some zoom in post. But a helicopter isn't enough. I would need it to land every now and then to shoot some drone footage from inside the canyons and whatever I will find on this way. And I would of course bring a scientist with me. So this has been on my plan for some time. However, since I got this news about how large earthquakes can get in Iceland, it changed my mind and I want to do my first documentary about this fault. And I have many good reasons for it. It's cheaper, I've already done a lot of the research, I already have some of the footage I need, so it has been doing a lot for me to prioritize my long list of projects. However, we all know that it takes only one strong earthquake swarm, and I'm somewhere out there for days shooting something like this, but it's just something that comes with the job, and I can actually handle it to have something like this in front of me. So there will of course be no changes when it comes to my updates, of course, but I do have to structure the rest of my channel better. There are videos that bring me income, others don't, and series like my town series will not do me justice as for view count until all episodes are online, covering all towns in Iceland, or some months of work still. So I have been putting a lot of my time and resources into long-term tasks, and I can only do so up to a limit, but I believe it's the right thing, however. No pain, no gain. So I'm doing my best to work around such obstacles, because at some time point, I believe that this work will make me a decent living. We all need to make mistakes, find out what's working or not, and YouTube has been this fantastic platform for that. But back to the Reykjanes Peninsula, as for the next days, I'm expecting some unrest, and it will be interesting to see if the Reykjanes Peninsula is heading into a new chapter. It doesn't look so now, Sunday afternoon, when I'm doing the voiceover. But I also think this is not just over yet. Just like by Lake Askja, where we are somewhere in a cycle that I think that will end up with an eruption sooner than later. And I will of course be ready for such an event up on the highlands or on the Reykjanes Peninsula or wherever. That is and will be my job. And with that, I'm sending you best regards. from the volcano island, Iceland.